So, going to call the meeting to order at 6:03. So, approval of the minutes for December 16th. Okay, so we have a motion to approve the minutes as written. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Minutes are approved as noted.
Seems like these speakers are awfully quiet tonight.
Well, okay. So, appearance of interested citizens. Samuel, would you like to come and speak to us for a minute? Right there, and make sure your microphone's on.
Perfect. What would you guys like to know?
What do you want?
Yes.
Well,
tell us why you're here and what you want to accomplish. Stand his name and where you live.
Well, I'm Sam Elder. I live off of Wiesner. So I live over by North Terrace Park. So that's okay. The closest park to me. Miss Reed kind of came up to me. She's my English teacher. She's like, Sam, I got a proposition for you. I'm like, oh, what's that? She's like, since you're in the scouting program and you like to do service, here's an assignment for you. So she gave me a little sign-up sheet for the liaison for the Parks Advisory Board and filled it out. So I came tonight to see what this is all about, more or less, see if it's worthwhile. And I kind of like it so far. It's interesting. It's different. It's different. So I should say that. Any other questions?
So, Mr. Chair, is this for the Parks Advisory Board or for the City Council? Because the City Council normally has a youth liaison, but I mean, if they're expanding it to Parks, I think that's.
No, this committee has had a liaison.
Oh, fantastic.
Good. We want.
Fantastic.
Perfect. I'll be here Thursday, so. Yeah.
Do you want him to sit over here?
Not yet. He's not. Sure. He's not the liaison.
Oh, he is? I thought he was.
He comes to a volunteer coordinating committee on Thursday. Okay.
I'll put it first.
Tell him we want you.
Yeah, well, appreciate that. I'll be here Thursday.
Great.
So what troop are you with?
I'm with Troop 167. That is the part of the LDS troop in 5th and Madison building, so part of that troop.
Eagle?
Yeah, actually, I had my last Eagle Board review on February 1st. Laura Reed was a part of it. And that was a fun, so I passed that. Okay. That was a fun experience. Fun Eagle project. That was a blast.
How many Eagle Scouts do we have?
Well,
I've just been a scout.
Just me.
Over 20 years.
I would raise my hand if I actually
have. Yeah, you haven't got it yet.
But I haven't got it yet, but I just passed the Eagle Board review, so.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
So you coming to Camp Ree at the end of the month, April?
I should.
Good.
Take off time off work so I can do that.
I do that.
Well, perfect.
All right.
Perfect. Is that all you guys need?
If that's all you want to say,
that's all
works for us.
Awesome. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Sam. Looking forward to working with you.
Nice to work with you, too, guys.
Gary?
Uh-oh, now there's trouble.
Uh-huh.
I'm excited to see
Someone
Gary.
Someone to say he wants to be on
Went
this board
from
again.
An up-and-comer to a more mature person. My name's Gary Whalen. I'm a Kaiser resident. I sent copies of what I'm going to read to you guys earlier today. I think Debbie included them in your packet, and I appreciate that. I really appreciate and respect the many hours that staff, the Parks Board members, and others have put into this survey that's out now. It's very important that we find a fair and effective way to stabilize parks funding. And we need to do that immediately, as well as into the future. I think we can all recognize that we are sliding backwards and that slope is getting slicker and faster until we can find some appropriate funding. While this survey can only broadly address the questions you have posed, I have a few that I think all Kaiserites need to know in order to reply and to make an informed decision. The only revenue source is the taxpayer slash ratepayer. Whether this is called a fee, a tax, or any other name, it all comes from the same revenue source, which is the citizen. Some of the questions I have is this fee proposed per meter?
No, it's per residence.
Per dwelling unit, to be exact.
Dwelling unit.
Okay.
So if there's 40 apartments, it's 40 dwelling units.
Okay. So 40 times 2 to 8?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Is this potential fee going to be set by a vote of the citizens or the council?
So the city council in their charter has the ability to do so through an advisory set of information, which is why we went the route we did with the survey, discussing the levels of maintenance and new facilities and amenities, as well as the levels of support on the back page of the survey. The council may do that. That's going to be entirely on them if they choose to go that route. Our recommendation is going to be solely based off of the information collected via the survey and representative of all of the information. So we're not going to just say, oh, we really want $4, so that's the only information we're going to give them. We're going to give them the full kit and caboodle so they can see the exact percentages of the responses that we've received. So that's a really short answer to saying the city council may do it. If the city council declines to take action on it, I think we've had some discussion about maybe introducing it via other means. But yes and yes, I guess, if that makes sense. Okay.
Is there a threshold of reply? I mean, we've got 35,000 citizens.
Right.
But there's a big chunk of those that won't get the survey, correct? Or do apartment dwellers get this? Multifamily units get this? Or
so
just their management company?
If Robert, correct me if I'm wrong, I think it was about 14,700 dwelling units that this was sent out to. Of that, Mr. Epley said that a good reply is generally somewhere in the ballpark of 3 to 5% of those surveyed. I think our goal is much higher than that. I think we want to get much, much higher than 10% response. So while it's not necessarily the total population of the city in terms of like a census, I think it's still representative well of the dwelling units. So we've seen surveys come back that have had as many as seven different people within the household. So they say, you know, we got X amount of people between this age and this age, and then so on and so forth. And so, So our goal is better than 10%. You know, realistically, like I said, right now I think we're over 5%, and we've got about a month left. So,
also, Gary, I wanted to let you know that we are doing everything we can to reach everybody. So even if they don't get a water bill, we're doing everything we can. We're walking the streets. We're talking to people.
That's right.
We're meeting with neighborhood groups. We're doing everything we can to reach out to individuals that did not get a survey to let them know how to find a survey, either written or going online, et cetera.
So. Well, I appreciate all the efforts, and I know you guys have been working on this for a long time, and I would just like to see it be as inclusive. And I know that surveys by themselves have a historically low response, and I wouldn't want that to be the one and only bellwether by which the success of this could be measured.
We're planning a couple open
town
work sessions, town hall meetings.
So to speak with what Jim said, we have on February 28th, we have reached out to all of the sports groups for the youth athletics and asked them to come to a town hall. I've emailed all of them. I've Facebooked all of them. I've received two responses so far, only from the soccer group and only from Kaiser Little League. So if you're a parent of youth athletics, talk to your people and let's make sure we fill this room up on February 27th with youth athletics. And again, I think we tentatively had one scheduled, I think, for March 9th, which was going to be our last town hall. Unfortunately, a scheduling conflict is precluding that, so we're going to have to look about doing it maybe later that week or the following week before March 15th when the survey closes.
Okay. Is this potential fee going to be assessed only to basically residential, or is it also commercial?
So it's going to residential. We targeted the dwelling units specifically because they're more than likely the folks that are going to be using the facilities. We did not approach businesses on this because the business relationships so far that we have with the park system generally garnered larger support than just, I don't want to say just, larger support for bigger projects. So that's where our the big dollar sponsorships and donations generally come from. And frankly, we have a lot of small business owners in Kaiser that, you know, if they get tagged at home, they don't necessarily want to get tagged again at their place of business. And so because it's typically a family type atmosphere, I think we chose to go that route versus, for lack of a better term, double dipping the businesses.
Well, also, Gary, that, you know, businesses are asked to give for so many things. Yeah. And I mean, you and I have business, we know how that is. And, you know, to have a parks fee, then you may cut down on, you know, if somebody wants to have them sponsor a Little League team, they say, well, I'm already giving to parks. I mean, what, you know, so.
So they wouldn't be assessed a fee if this is, okay, that, I just want clarification on that.
I think it's important to point out, this is all recommendations. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, the city council may have a differing opinion on that, and I can't project what the city council may or may not want to do with this. That is going to be, I think we're all fairly on board with the fact that that's going to be our recommendation to them. Again, we're not the city council. We can't necessarily project what it is our decision is going to be. Clint.
Okay. Is this $2 to $8 potential fee capped at that amount, or does it escalate by ordinance or by action of council? And if it could escalate,
you
is
know,
there a formula and process by which that
well, you being on council, you know that whatever you do, future councils aren't locked into that. And so to try and say, well, a future council wouldn't do change this, we can't say. The idea behind it is no. And I don't recall a whole lot. I don't recall any times that we've gone anything like this where the 12 years I was on council that we ever changed anything. but again, future councils can do what they want.
Okay. So I guess part of that question would be then, would this, and again, this is a council, I know you guys are an advisory board like most of our commissions are, but is it your, do you have a recommendation to the council that this be tied to, you know, they could structure an ordinance or a statute. It's not a city charter amendment like the water revenues were, but that this would basically say this is what it is. And the other councils, while they can still change it, it would make it more difficult to change, whether that be to protect it or to negate it, whichever way they wanted to go.
So I think the challenge with that is it's really going to depend on the level. If the council chooses to move forward, what the level is, right? So if it's at the higher dollar level, I think that it might be something worth reevaluating at towards the end of like a master plan completion. The challenge with that then becomes you have a lot more resources and a lot more assets than you did when you started the project. And so the dollar, the maintenance and operation needs grow with the increases of new amenities and new resources. And so I think it's our response that this maintains as a sustainable revenue resource versus going back and reevaluating. I think if there is a reevaluation of it, it's going to have to be, it's probably have to go through a very similar process that we're going through now. I don't know. Again, like Jim said, we can't say what a future council is going to do, sure. But that's going to be certainly our recommendation that this is really driven towards completing the master parks plan after all the maintenance and operation issues are taken care of first.
Okay. Well, and that's another question. So does this potential fee sunset or does it just continue into perpetuity as it's proposed by or thought of by this board?
Well, I don't think it's sunset of a future council wanted it to. Again, we can't. There isn't anything. It's like if we said, well, we only want it for 7 years, where would we come up with that? you know, we can't tell the future about what revenues are going to be or anything. And that kind of ties into your next one about the 2.5 to 3% that is currently taken from the city budget.
Well,
and it's actually, what, about 3.2, Robert?
Currently.
Yeah.
But we're guaranteed 2.5.
Right. That's not going to change.
No.
This is not going to, this is added on to that.
Okay, but Jim, when you say it's not going to change, maybe the intent of this council or city manager, or what, you know, all those people that turn the budget wheels around, future council could say, okay, for example, you know, there's a need and a desire for more police officers. Well, if suddenly you have, say, $4, whatever amount that comes to, and then come next budget cycle or five budget cycles from now, they say, well, here's this 2.5% from general fund. We can take that out of parks now because they have this other fee, and then we can move that money over to support new police officers, which,
well,
might be justifiable.
I don't think
you
might.
You could, but, you know, that's robbing Peter to pay Paul, and we've done that in the past, and it doesn't work. You know, sooner or later, the chickens come home to roost, and right now they have because we cannot maintain the parks now.
Right.
If our tax base, Kaiser Station is fully built out, some other things, there's going to be more revenue coming into from property taxes. You know, maybe that changes it a little bit. Who knows? But again, it's looking in a crystal ball. So we kind of put this as, if things stayed, you know, we kind of looked at, well, what are the costs going to be down the road? And that's all kind of figured into these percentages or the dollars amount. But yeah, to have this replace, that was talked about. In fact, I talked to Chris Epley about that a little bit, just asked what would the ramifications be, and it's not good. I mean, that's basically like having a tax district, a separate tax district for park district, and it's just not a good idea.
So at this point in time, there has been no decision to do that.
Well,
how is that? The way it is at this point in time, that's the decision that's
right.
Made. Okay.
I asked Chris Epley and the city council that question just, what, a week or
it was about a month ago, yeah.
And he came out and said, absolutely no, we would not do that. But you
correct.
Bring up a good point here. We need to probably look at that. By him saying that, can they bind future city councils? Because if they turn around, this is something that I brought this up 4 or 5 times because I'm really concerned about that. We get this thing going and all of a sudden, who has always suffered when they need money for something else? They take it away sometimes from parks. So I have a big concern with what you're saying, and that's a good point, and somehow we need to re-talk to the city council about that.
Well, I'm not sure, Clint, how you could bind them.
I'd like to give the council the benefit of the doubt. If the council chooses to move forward with this, they have the vision of the need. They've heard the responses of the citizens of Kaiser, all of us sitting up here at the dais, everybody out here, with the exception of Robert, because he doesn't live in Kaiser.
He's just here.
He's a Kaiser guy through and through. But anyways, you know, they hear the responses. I think that the city council, if they choose to move forward with this, I think they're going to understand the need longevity-wise of this type of a fee. And so, you know, I think before we make any assumptions on, you know, what Mr. Anderson might say or what, you know, anybody else on the group may or may not, or the council may or may not say, I think we need to give them the benefit of the doubt that they're going to want to do the right thing for this. Mr. Epley is on the record stating that the 2.5, even at this point, the 3% wouldn't change. And boy, I bet there's 9 of us on this board that'd be really upset if that conversation started to change as this fee gets discussed even further.
And I'm not trying to question the integrity or intent of any of the current members. I truly believe that. And I believe that's true also of Mr. Epley.
Right.
But none of them are always going to be here. And so I'm not talking just for now and the next X amount of months or years. I'm talking about, you know,
we don't want to do this in 20 years again.
In 1983, when the city of Kaiser took over in a friendly takeover with the Kaiser Water District, it was added in by a charter amendment to protect those fees so they could only be used for water-related, direct water-related activities. Mm-hmm. And in about, I don't remember exactly, 87 or 88, there was many discussions about, well, gee, maybe we could just work around that somehow. And there was a period of time of at least a half a dozen years when, because taxes don't come in until the fall, as you all know, there was money taken out of water revenue as a interdepartmental loan or whatever the terminology is. And yes, they were paid back, but unfortunately, during that period of time, there was construction and maintenance that should have been happening that was deferred and delayed. So just like fixing the skateboard park over here, the longer you wait, the longer it costs. Right. And, you know, our reason our water rates are half those of Salem, approximately, is because we're able to maintain and develop the water system as it's needed, because the money is there. It's not a general fund item. And again, not castigating any of the board members or the current council, I'm just trying to look ahead, because we've seen this, maybe not here, but we've seen it in every community around us. So anyhow, that's where...
Well, Gary, it's still back to the same thing. You can't bind other city councils.
You could amend the city charter and bind the people.
Yeah, but that's...
That's not the most practical way, but no, that might be the only logistic way to do it.
I really find it, you know, and you can remember when you were on that they used to borrow from SDCs. And some of the new legislation has gone through the state and stuff. You can't do that stuff anymore like you used to be able to. Mm-hmm. But I think this is... Any money that comes from this will be dedicated. It will be a dedicated, you know, if you're paying $4 a month to go to parks, that's where it's going. It can't be borrowed to put somewhere else.
Okay.
So.
Any budget item can be borrowed temporarily in order to satisfy a need if paid back. You know, it's not like it's cut in stone. I mean, that happens in tight of budgets. Those things happen as long as the base fees are the same.
Okay.
So we can't say, no, it wouldn't ever happen. It may. They may have to for some reason at some point, for short term, a loan, whatever. You know, well, it's hard to look into the future. You know, we would love to be able to say we are big enough to have a parks district where we would have a setup where the fee would come into us and it would not be touched by anybody else. But we've determined at this point in time that we're not at that place.
Okay.
So that's been looked at.
Okay. Well, you know, I think you can gather I'm a very strong proponent of parks and the city of Kaiser and all the activities that happens here. I mean, my kids and now my grandkids have utilized these parks since the early 70s when they were Marion County Parks.
Right.
So, you know, that either means that they've been there a long time or I've been around too long. I'm not sure which that means. But I think in order to garner the trust and the support of the Kaiserites for this fee, because we are asking people to dip into their pockets, that should be find some methodology to permanently and wholly, by statute ordinance, that the revenue percentage received now, that 2.5 to 3%, whatever the actual number is, be tied directly to the assessed fee. And if any or all of that general fund money goes away, the fee should stop right with it. So we're either all in or all out. That way it's pretty cut and dried. And it could be structured that way, I believe.
What would be the advantage of that, Gary?
Pardon me?
What would be the advantage of that?
I think it would give leverage to future parks boards and to people using the parks that they know they've paid into this and they're going to have 100% of it. They're not going to have 75% of it, or whatever that is, if you, you know, if for some reason, it might be totally justifiable, but if $300,000 of general fund disappears, then that can go with it. Because you can't assess people on a story of, we're going to do this because you're getting this, and then jerk it away.
That's a really interesting approach. Yeah, I think that's a really interesting approach.
But not the general fund part.
The general fund part is a designated percentage.
Well, yeah, we
not,
did
not by
we did
not
that
by
in 2000.
That's by the will
well,
of the council.
By charter, but
that's right.
We did that in 2003.
Right.
When Mike Gaynor and I were on, and until then, it was just kind of, well, whatever's left, Parks gets. Mm-hmm. And most of the years, it's been above that amount.
Right.
And I just don't see that changing, Gary. I don't, because
right
now at 3.2%, we're going in the hole. So, you know, it would get to a point where you're actually talking about closing parks down. So I don't see a council now or in the future doing that.
I don't either. But I've also been around long enough to know that those things happen not by trying to strip away something that's what was well-intended and meaningful, but because circumstances may call for it. So anyhow, I just wanted to share that with you and encourage you guys. Thank you for all the work you're doing on this, and see if you can't incorporate some of that into your, I'll call it, negotiations with the council for the benefit of the citizens. Thank you very much. Any other questions?
No, Gary, and I appreciate it. You know, we've had a couple conversations, and you know, I do appreciate your support, and these are really good questions. I think these are things that generally we've thought about. It is a challenge. We basically were given one page and some spots online to put some of this up, and so we may want to maybe entertain a frequently asked questions page or something where we can throw some of these things on there. So, you know, there's certainly food for thought here. You know, we can talk to amongst ourselves and talk to staff and see what the appropriate levels of being able to respond to some of those things. Again, it's kind of like, I don't know how hard we can hold the council's hand on definitively answering these, other than just saying this is our recommendation as an advisory board. But
so just to let you know, I'm going to compile a lot of comments that have come in with surveys. I'm going to add this to that. So, and we're going to share that with the city council. Some people have taken time, like you have, to write out letters to us about what their ideas are. So those things are not going to go unanswered or unlooked at.
Good. Well, I appreciate your time, and I look forward to great parks for a long time. And it's your hard work that's going to help us get there.
No.
So thank you very much.
Thanks, Gary.
Just
certainly. That's
enough. Easy to get to.
Okay. Number four, election of chair and vice chair.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to nominate David Loudon as the chair and Jim Taylor as vice chair.
Second. Is there any other nominations? Hearing none, I guess. Do I need a motion to vote, or we just vote?
You need a motion.
You don't need you nominated. It wasn't motions. It's just nominations. You had those nominations, and if there's no objections, it can be unanimous consent.
Yeah.
Are there any objections?
You know, Dylan's gone. We could have hit Dylan on it, but
yeah, we could have. So, it passes unanimously.
Yay!
Boy, that was the toughest election I've been in.
Yeah.
Okay, so
pounded.
Now we're in new business, old business, and I'm going to move solar eclipse event to the top because one of our members needs to leave soon. Okay, Gwen?
Oh. Nothing to say.
You have nothing to say.
I haven't been able to make a meeting in 3 months because they conflict with this meeting.
Well, I can kind of tell you where we are. We're going to have three concerts there, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and also the people that are Sunday will also perform on Monday just before the eclipse. The bathrooms, which was a concern because bathrooms are already kind of taken up. We've got all the bathrooms taken care of, wash stations. I'm even talking to the sanitary people so we don't get any problems where people dump their waste wherever they're parked. So they're going to go around in RVs and every day maybe and see about some people want theirs pumped. So that will help us right there to make sure we don't get into problems later on. Lights, I've got three lights, those great big lights if everybody has ever seen them. They're not bright, but they cover a big area. Tom Hsu, our partner out there, is going to furnish three of those. So that's going to help us. Been talking with the cadets and the police department, and I think we're going to have some security out there, which is going to help because I think we need that with as many people that's going to be there. And then plus I'm going to have my normal security there when the concerts are going on. The only concern I have, and I'll leave that to Robert to talk about, we were going to seed and grass all that area, so it was really nice, and that's probably not going to happen, but that part I'll let Robert talk about.
Yeah, basically what it comes down to is we're required to have a certain permit to disturb over an acre of ground at a time now near the river due to the soil runoff potential into the river, and we just simply don't have the funds available for that permit. It's an $1,800 expense that came at us completely unexpected just for the permit, and it takes over a month to get, which puts us beyond the DEQ, puts us beyond the time frame that we would need to get the ground plowed and seeded. And I know Clint worked hard behind the scenes to get some volunteers to come forward for that. But
so you said a month for the 1200C?
Approximately.
Because when I talked to them, they said it was almost a year.
No.
None of these have been added in?
That's not accurate. Bill, unless there's some other issues there that I don't know about.
Bill says it's going to be a year, too.
I'd heard a couple different dates.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Yeah, it's unfortunate, but is what it is.
Should be a great event. I just hope, you know, the area for the campers is okay. So,
Mr. Chair, yes. My apologies for being late. I got recruited to sit in for somebody at the last minute, so I apologize for being late. Just a question about that. How does that impact this event if you can't apply for a permit?
So, what Clint's referring to is the field that has been proposed where potential campers would be camping is kind of rough. The idea came up that we would try to get some volunteer efforts together to try to plow the field with commercial ag equipment, basically, and level it off. Because if you look at it, there are a lot of imperfections in the soil out there, and it could make a little bit of a challenge for certain vehicles to navigate the field, you know, without getting stuck, or, you know, it's kind of lumpy bumpy. So in order to do that work prior to the event is where the permit would come into place.
Mm-hmm. And we're talking 7.5 acres, which is huge.
It needs to be done eventually and not just for this event.
Right. Well, these guys would have done it. These guys would have done it professionally. It would only cost us about $3,500. And but we'll have to worry about that another time now.
To prepare the land for folks to, for like RV sites and so forth?
No, for tent camping.
Tent camping.
That field out there is like, it's like a bombs went off. There's big holes, there's roots from old trees, there's brush, there's, you know, so it just was going to be completely leveled out and seeded.
Okay. So without that happening, can it still happen?
Oh,
or
yes.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
still going,
not
going
to be great, but okay.
That area is scheduled to be an open area anyway, so it needs to be done.
Mm-hmm.
Someday it needs to be done.
You have to apply for a DEQ permit, huh?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
In order to disturb more than 1 acre of land.
Stir up the dirt, then they
expose the soil is basically what
The other thing we were, the reason we wanted to do the job right, because eventually we'd put irrigation in after we get it all seeded. But then the cities and parks are going to have another maintenance deal that they're going to have to take care of, because that's a lot of acres.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So
get sheep.
Or goats.
Yes, not goats. Goats don't eat grass, they eat brush.
Oh, that's true, they do. They eat
sheep
everything
eat
else.
They eat
Well, you need, so you need two goats and then a whole bunch of sheep.
Well, and
a herder.
Mr. Chair.
You can do that, Donna.
I'd like to point out, you know, this is $1,800 holding up the success, well, not success, holding up a big event that's going to happen in Kaiser, holding up potential development later down the road. And once again, I think it just articulates the struggles that Robert is facing as it relates to the ability to maintain and operate our parks. So again, if you're watching this, please go to kaiser.org, click on the scrolling banner, and take the survey. Thank you.
Yes.
Let me ask just one more question. Yes. If you were to, if these funds were magically to appear, would you still be able to file the paperwork and everything to make it happen in time for this, to get things squared away for this event?
I'd have to talk to the volunteers that are available. I don't know what their time frame is. You know,
how about getting it approved through the state?
Well, I was told the approval of the permit would take about 4 to 5 weeks, upwards of 6, but most likely 4 to 5 weeks. So that puts us, you know, late March.
I think we need to call
to answer that question in case the money someday, the money does come up. Why don't we go ahead and get the permit because it's probably good for a year or two?
Well,
why wait and then?
I don't think we're going to buy a permit that we don't know for sure we're going to do the work. And I think there is a time frame. I need to look into that. There is an expiration of when the work has to take place on the permit.
Of course.
The other side of this, guys, is if we develop the land and you grade that, now you're setting the expectation to have, you know, quality turf there. And again, you're talking 7.5 acres of graded turf that the park staff is now going to have to attempt to mow.
That's
where right now we mow it as a field maybe once or twice a year just to keep a fire danger dandelions down. But, you know, if we grade that out and we plant soil, you know, a good seed, you know, we're going to be out there with our equipment, you know, weekly mowing that like Claggett Creek Park. And the talk of irrigation comes into it. You know, when do you put irrigation on it? Should you put irrigation on it? I mean, you're investing into the land. You should probably irrigate it. Well, I mean, we are in no place right now to be taking on an additional 7.5 acres of irrigated turf. I can't fit it in. I don't have the equipment. I don't have the manpower. So there's two sides to it.
Yes, Matt.
That's why we're doing the survey, because we can't maintain and operate what we have. The same conversation came up when we looked at the other grant. You know, I think on this one, yeah, it's unfortunate that we may not be able to get it for the event, but when we're struggling to get $3,600 to fix a safety issue as it relates to a piece of play equipment, I am personally would be an absolute hard no vote on any discussion moving forward with this effort, even if we got the $1,800 for a permit, especially when we have too much maintenance and operation issues at this point already needing to be addressed.
Any other comments? All right, let's move on to HEAL. It's under council review.
I can report on that a little bit. At the previous council meeting, council considered the motion that Parks Board made to become a HEAL city. Basically, what came of it, there's a lot of great things about becoming a HEAL city, and I think council noted a lot of those great things. They had a major concern with, you know, what does it all entail? What are the details of it? There was a lot of questions being asked, and I think a lot of them didn't feel comfortable moving forward with this until those questions are answered. So what it sounded like was they'd really like Parks Board to come back to the next council meeting, or if that's too early, you know, following, maybe one of the newer members or somebody on Parks Board could research in depth what a HEAL city is and go back to council and report to them and give them some solid information and be able to answer some questions for them. So I don't know if, you know, anybody here would be willing to take that on by next Tuesday's meeting. But a lot, most of the information's online. It'd just be a lot of reading and familiarizing yourself with it.
Compile a list of questions they have so we know what they're looking for?
Not formally. You could watch the last council meeting online and hear some of the questions that were asked. I know Councilor Anderson had some good questions that came up. I don't know if he wanted to.
I could fill in a little bit here.
Oh, good.
Just as we were, well, first off, when the League of Oregon Cities conference was here in Salem, I went by the HEAL booth, or HEAL, whatever, mm-hmm. entity group booth, and that sounded like a wonderful idea. Oh, and then getting the item up on the agenda, that sounded like a, you know, great, you know, I mean, who would not be in favor of getting or encouraging folks to be more active and eat healthier and so forth and so on. if you look as one word looks at the big packet, which we kind of just got to us, a few unanswered questions just with respect to some of the terms that they used in that were not defined at all. And I'm sorry, I don't have the information in front of me here to elaborate on that point. Just some of the terms that were utilized there throughout that. If we're accepting grants, okay, what's that mean? You know, generally you've got some strings that are going to be applied or from
always.
Whatever
always.
Group.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what's going to be expected or required of Kaiser were we to accept dollars for something? Okay. So, and I would love to get grant dollars to, I don't know, buy a new piece of play equipment or what have you. But so there weren't just some, the ability to answer those questions were a little bit challenging. Or weren't there. So just getting some more information, I think, on that, what was part of it. One item that comes to mind is, are there going to be some issues with respect to, are we going to have to redo or adjust our density or land use planning requirements? Because there is a significant section in that HEAL thing about land use. And so that, I mean, for me, that was a big flag. I don't know what that means. We're going to go in and have to tweak our land use development code somehow in order to, you know, comport with this grant. So that was just something that, those are just a couple of things that stood out to me.
Hmm. So, yeah, I don't recall, of course, that doesn't mean anything. If we ever saw the packet.
You did. It was actually council got the same packet that I printed out for you the week, the meeting before. So they got that same one.
I didn't see the thing on the land density thing. Of course, that's all set.
There are four major issue areas in HEAL. Land use and something, sustainability is another one or one or two.
Well, when we did periodic review, that stuff was all in there.
And maybe what we have presently aligns with that. But when you take a look at that as a major topic item, I don't know what that means and how it fits in with where, and nobody could answer that question.
So it was kind of vague.
It was extremely vague. Yeah. It was terms just not defined. And so that was, I think, the general consensus of folks. Hey, we need some more information before we could proceed with something like that. And specifically, if we're accepting grants, is there, you know, what's our kind of, what? Okay, so you get our dollars, and here's what you got to do. So that's, just wanted to get a better understanding of that.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
When the board asked me to print out the packet for them about the HEAL program, I just cut and pasted pages out of their website because their website is quite extensive. So the vagueness in the packet, I am sure, would be all clarified once, if somebody wanted to volunteer to go online. They have a wonderful website with all kinds of links you can click on to get answers. So I think that whoever volunteered to do that would probably be able to find all those answers pretty easily.
And if I might, just there was one other section that was in there, and that there were a lot of different city ordinances and rules and so forth that were referenced in there. And I didn't, that was unclear as to what those were there for. And it, you know, I mean, is that, are those just a, hey, here are some ideas you could possibly look at? I just get a little concerned when I see things from Portland and Vancouver and, you know, other areas up in the metro area, and they don't necessarily align with other parts of the state, especially Kaiser. Oh,
the tax base alone.
Yeah. Yeah, so anyway, so I hope that gives you a general idea.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do we have a volunteer?
I'll take that on.
All right.
Being that I'm apparently supposed to be reporting to the council anyway, I don't know what that means, but it'll give me something to do.
It just, if I might.
You probably need your packet.
talk to Debbie.
Well, okay. You really shouldn't use the packet. You just need to go to the Heal Cities website. And that's because the packet is incomplete and the website is complete.
Right. And if it works out that you could, you know, this can come together by that meeting or maybe March or, you know, whatever. I don't think there was a real definite urgency to have that.
Done this year.
So, Joe, I just sent you the link for the policies things, and as it relates to the land use and transportation aspect, basically what it says is that they want you to look at some of the alternatives in terms of you know, some of the things are safe routes to schools and programs and other things that help minimize the time and distance that folks have to go to, but I'll send you the link to it. I don't think it's necessarily very restrictive, but those are especially when you dive into land use, those are things that typically makes people's toes cringe.
Because that's a, when you first started talking about it, it sounded like Kaiser's already hit most of the marks.
Yeah.
As opposed to some other cities that we already are in line with what they're looking for. So, good luck.
I'll talk to you after the meeting what you need to do for the reporting. Okay.
Thank you.
Now our favorite topic, park stabilization funding / community-based outreach. Woo-hoo. You have any comments, Matt?
I will say, so we've been live now since December 29th on the survey online. It went out in the utility bills in hard copy. Everybody that gets a utility bill in hard copy has or should have received them by now. I know that Debbie and Robert have given over, I'd say probably north of 600 hard copy email or hard copy survey responses. And we've gotten quite a bit online as well. We've done multiple outreaches. Our first outreach was sort of the council work session in which we only had, I think, three people in the audience, so that was a little bit disappointing that we didn't have more people engaged in that, but that was our first official kickoff. Since then, we've been to the Southeast Kaiser Neighborhood Association, where Dylan and Joe went down and did a presentation for them. I heard really, really good reviews from people that I know in the SECNA group, and they were very appreciative of the professionalism of both Joe and Dylan. We've gone to the West Kaiser Neighborhood Association last week, 9 persons in attendance there. For the most part, they were very interested. They asked some very, very good questions related to the survey. A lot of the questions were driven towards a lack of understanding overall of how Measure 47 and Measure 50 affect the city's ability to raise revenues. There was some concern about the amount of system development charges that are not being able to be used, and there was a lot of discussion about the maintenance and operations being a massive priority over new amenities. Now, that doesn't mean to say that we can't replace things as part of a maintenance and operation type thing, but that was one of their major concerns. A lot of concerns in addition about folks that are on fixed incomes and how this may or may not affect them. And again, I think the city council is very aware of folks that are facing those issues and are prepared to have conversations about that. We've done, I did a talk at the Kaiser Rotary, which I don't generally get nervous when I talk in front of folks, and I was extremely nervous talking to those people because You know, Rotary is very key to the success of why Kaiser is the kind of community it is, and to the point where I actually called Scott White, Sean White, mostly because I was watching X Games videos, I think, earlier that day. But, you know, it just speaks to the volume of how important the Rotary is to this group in terms of the city. We've had two work days on Saturdays. The first work day, myself and Counselor Ryan and my 10-year-old daughter were there. We went out and handed out flyers in front of a couple businesses. And I will tell you that the responses we received from most folks were generally very good. We saw a spike in the YouTube video views within 24 hours of handing those surveys out. And we had another one work day, I think last Saturday, where we had Donna and Amy and another person showed up, and I fail to remember her name.
Meredith Mooney,
thank you. And they did some more outreach. I was doing a Clagger Creek Watershed Council event, and I was cleaning up Ben Miller Park, which, oh my gosh, I've never seen more leaves in my life. Randy Miller was, well, Randy Miller was on a leaf blower for like 4.5 hours, and I think myself and Mark Callier probably took north of 15 tarps full of the leaves to create natural ground cover down along the creek bank. But good work done there. Southeast Kaiser Neighborhood Association was there as well. We have two more work sessions coming up, March 4th and March 11th. The 11th one, I'm going to need somebody to kind of run that one because I'm going to be here at City Hall doing the Civic Center cleanup. So that's going to be a big event. The 27th of February, we have scheduled the Parks and Youth Athletics meeting. I've reached out to all of the youth athletics via email, via Facebook message, and I've gotten responses from only two. Thankfully, Brad Armsmeyer has gotten a hold of me, and he's going to rally some folks, and then the soccer folks also contacted me.
Matt, do you have phone numbers available for those groups?
I've got them on the websites. I haven't made any phone calls.
I would call
yet.
Them personally.
Okay. That'd be great.
Like I said before, it's like herding cats.
Well, and it's a busy time for them right now because they're all doing registrations for kids and stuff. But at the same time, it's the perfect time
well,
to try to get those guys
Well, they all have
roped
fairly
in.
Large boards.
Right.
They can get somebody there.
Yeah. I know Brad has expressed a lot of interest in getting the majority of the board members here for Kaiser Little League, so we're excited about that. So we did have a tentative date of March 9th scheduled to do our final I think I already talked about this. I'm having massive deja vu, but do our final meeting, town hall, but we're going to have to reschedule that because of a conflict with basically West Kaiser Neighborhood was going to host it, but they've elected to have Chief Teague there to talk about the police initiative, which I think is fantastic and extremely vital to the success of public safety in the city. So we're going to look at some alternative dates for that. You know, as I mentioned earlier, we want to fill the room up with people on every side of the issue because I don't want to hear just from the people that are waving pom-poms and really excited about it. I think we have to hear from everybody that this affects. I have sent out, I don't even know how many emails, dozens and dozens of emails with various updates, both to City Council and the Parks Board with some tasks. If you haven't otherwise looked at those, please do so and get back to me or just let me know they're done. We're still researching the sign. It's expensive. I looked at a couple different vinyl signs to go on the northwest corner of River and Lock Haven. The cheapest one I was able to find was north of $350. And I just don't have that kind of personal money to float for that kind of thing. I know Mr. Holland is working on, we've had some conversations about doing one at the focal point there. I just need to get him that information, and I have failed to do so, so that's my fault. What else? So we've got two YouTube videos up. One was done by, the photos were taken by Kat Gaynor, and we've got some really nice music to it that is designed to evoke emotion. And
should have been Pink Floyd.
Well, you know, it's sad because if it's copyrighted music, you can't use it on YouTube.
Yeah, we know that Roger Waters is into suing people, so.
So we've gotten about 100 views on that, so that's pretty exciting. But actually more exciting, we did have a McNary student come together with Dylan, and they put together about a minute and 40-second long video, and it's really well done. This kid brought a drone in, got some drone footage. It's an amazing video, and it's got good data. I'm really appreciative that they were able to get that taken care of. And so if you haven't seen it, go check it out. It's on kaiser.org. Click the scrolling banner on the top and find the YouTube video. Not opposed to self-promotion here. I think that's it. You know, the Facebook campaign has been okay. I've lost many friends on Facebook. My old colleagues from the United States Navy are asking me what I'm doing with my life these days. Most of my family and Eugene have blocked me. So, you know,
my wife blocked me a long time.
It is what it is, you know, but if we're friends on Facebook, please, please, please. I know Kat's done a great job. Donna's done a great job. And Clint and Jim have also done a great job of spreading it on their pages. But, you know, the saturation is the key. As Mr. Whalen brought up earlier in his testimony, it's really important that we reach out to everybody on every different level we can. We've gotten really no response from the faith-based organizations to try to get in and have conversations with those folks, which is fine. But we'd really like to still have those conversations. You know, if anybody's got ideas, let's move on it. But we've got a month, and typically with these kind of things, you don't really see a lot of traction on the get-go, and we've seen pretty good traction, and I'm just hoping that we can build a very good head of momentum heading into these final days of the survey. As of tomorrow, we'll have about a month left. I'd say we're probably about 700, just maybe a little north of that.
Is that counting the online, too?
Yeah.
Is it?
Well, I don't know. I think we're 700 or 800. I think that's both online and the hard copy surveys that have been entered in online. I think the last time Don and I talked about it, there's about 600. So we actually might be close to 8 because there's quite a large stack over there with Donna now. So
if you have 800, that's a good response for a little over halfway into this.
Yeah, and like I said, I think my goal certainly has been that I've been really putting out on Facebook because I'd like better than 10%. You know, yeah, 10%, you're still missing 90% of those surveyed, but yeah, I mean, it's really hard.
If they don't care to do the surveys.
You know, and it's funny because it sounds stupid, but I want people to be upset about this because I want them to have to come talk to us about it. And what I've found as a general rule is they come in and they have the conversations, they go, oh, okay. And I've had probably a half a dozen people that I've talked to in the last week and a half that have said, man, I filled it out. And I said, there's no way I'm supporting this. But now that we've had the conversation, I want to send another survey in. I said, well, feel free. You know,
reading some of the responses here on the stack that Donna has, that they either didn't read it all or didn't understand it.
That's right.
You know, like, why doesn't Kaiser have just vote to have a higher tax base?
That's right.
Well,
and that's
because it's against state law.
That's right.
And well, and things
don't know that.
Exactly. And that's why so much of this has been educational to people. And like you say, when you talk to them, then they get it. So
well, and people are, you know, they're passionate either way about it. You know, I would estimate that so far we're better than 70% in response that have said that they would support something. I don't know what that level is, but again, as we told Mr. Whalen earlier, we're not going to present just what makes us feel good about the responses. We're going to present the city council the facts and the facts only, with the recommendation clearly that I think is going to be indicative of the response that we get from folks. Really, really good responses from our 55 and older group. I think generally they're the largest group of folks that have responded on this, and that to me gives a lot of confidence to this process because it's generally the 55 and older group that are engaged and are, in some cases, not necessarily willing to support something like this. And we've gotten a tremendous amount of support and a tremendous amount of response from that group, and so I'm very appreciative of that.
We are the responsible people of Kaiser, you know.
Well, your peers might be, Mr. Taylor. That's you know, again, the outreach is so important. You know, Amy Ryan has been absolutely, Council Ryan has been absolutely fantastic in being a huge ambassador for this. I think I talked to her about every other day about, you know, what can we do? What can we do better? How can we do the outreach better? What can I do? You know, this is a woman that's working three jobs right now and still doing her best to try to help the effort, because I truly believe that she knows the success of this is going to be contingent on the volume of responses. And, you know, I've heard from Council Parsons, and I've heard from the mayor, and I've heard from a few others on, you know, the availability of them being able to help, be able to help out with this. And so, again, I'm excited. Got a lot of work to do. But go to kaiser.org, click on the scrolling banner on top, and please take the survey.
Matt, when's the, what's the deadline?
So the Ides of March. That just ended up being what it was. It's just March 15th is the last. Well, and what that did, Council Anderson, thank you for asking. It gave us about 45 days. The need to get it done that quickly was going to be getting in front of City Council, getting City Council's opinion on it, so that we could get it to the parks, or not the parks, it's all about parks to me, to the budget folks, should the City Council choose to move forward with this process. Because realistically, if this were to go forward, Robert would probably need at least a quarter, if not two quarters of revenue before really beginning anything, I think, just to be safe. I don't know. I mean, it's his program, but I don't think that he's going to want to operate it in that loss. But that's them. But yeah, it's going to be a fast and furious turnaround. And I imagine the police discussion is going to probably be going on right around the same time. And so,
I also can't imagine just one public hearing on this. I would imagine, Bruce, what do you think? It'd probably be a couple. That would only be one public hearing on this. At least it would be one that may be continued.
At least one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And things like, anytime you're talking revenue like this, you know, people come out of the woodwork and people, you just don't have time to do everything. So what they would do is not close the public hearing and then carry it, on to the next council meeting.
Yeah,
I hope that it's more than one public hearing. I really do, because that means people are engaged.
No, I think, Jim, you're right. I think anytime, you know, when you're talking about a big change, if you will, mm-hmm. people are going to want to weigh in on it. And, you know, when I was on the chairing the Planning Commission, we had to make sure folks got a chance to weigh in on different issues, especially when it came to doing something different up at what's now Kaiser Station. So,
well, Area C was a root canal. That was terrible.
So that's generally it in a nutshell. Donna's got some more information than I do. So again, go to kaiser.org, click on the scrolling banner, and take the survey. Thank you.
Do you have anything to say, Donna?
I do. I'm going to even turn on my own mic.
You just forget to turn it off.
No.
Oh.
Good. First of all, I want to let you know that on my kitchen table is a printout of a graph showing what the percentages are of the different options. That was going to come down with me tonight, but it didn't. So I'm going to send it to Debbie and see if she can send it out to everybody, because I think you'll be pleased to see what the responses are. I can just tell you off the top of my head that we have approximately 550 in there now. And
you
that
haven't counted a lot of these up, right?
Well, and I've got another probably a couple hundred sitting here that haven't been input yet. Right now, number three option, as we suspected, is running the highest, the middle option. But surprisingly, number five option is within a couple of percentage points of the being the same as the number three option, which I was surprised. It's our highest option. So people do want to do something, we feel. The other thing I wanted to share with you is that as I'm going through all of these, I'm seeing some very interesting comments. And I'm going to compile a listing of the comments and how many people had those comments, those ideas. There's also some people who took, pardon me, took time to write letters. And I'm going to share those with the board for sure and the council. I think we need to acknowledge people that are really involved and really want us to hear their voice, and we want to let them know that we are going to respond to them in some way, either on this venue or a phone call or whatever, depending on what the issue was.
You know, Donna, when we've done, I think they did a citizen survey, it was going out this year. Am I correct, Debbie?
Normally it's done
every other year.
Yes, but they haven't started anything yet.
Oh, okay.
So I am not sure.
Well, they're not going to do it then because they wouldn't have time, but. We would get the whole thing, and all the comments mm-hmm. would be on that citizen survey. Mm-hmm. And it's actually kind of fun reading if you want to know the truth.
So that's my goal, is to put all of those comments together so that we have a feeling for what people are thinking and feeling. And then if there are specific questions that we feel we want to respond to, we can. So that's all I have.
Do you have any other comments?
So the go.
Yeah. I do have one more comment. So I was able to come down last Saturday and help with the flyers. And imagine my disappointment when not one person besides myself from this Parks Board showed up. And in fact, there was a interested citizen that did show up and did take a handful of cards and did go out on her own time, which I was very thankful for. So my question is to this group, we have two more coming up on March 4th and March 11th. Which nights, which days can you sign up for to come and get some cards and hand them out? Because we all feel that one-on-one public contact is important. But we can't do it on two or three people. We have to all get involved.
So I have received a couple comments from a few folks about previous travel plans and things like that. I'm not going to say names, but no. we can definitely touch bases on there. But rather than, I think, you know, we can communicate on this on email maybe, or if you know that you can make either March 4th or March 11th now, then let's go ahead and, you know, be willing to do that. Again, I need somebody to do the 11th because I've got the Watershed Council cleanup here at the Civic Center. And I was not there last weekend because I was doing the Watershed Council thing, but, you know, I coordinated with Donna for that effort. But, you know, it is important. And I know that Council Anderson's excited to come out and help us out with this. And
I understand that Council will be hearing from Amy as well.
I'm sure I'll be talked to by Council Anderson after this meeting. Go to Kaiser.org, click on the scrolling banner on top, take the survey.
Thank you.
Are you going to talk about solar eclipse?
Mm-mm. We already talked about the solar eclipse.
But did you doze off?
No, I thought you had more to.
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
I've got way too much on my plate right now.
You need to stay awake, Jim.
It's the drugs.
Oh.
I'm not taking, I'm taking antibiotics.
See?
Yeah, uh-huh. That's what they all say. Whatever. Okay, Robert, do you want to bring us back to reality now?
Here. Just want to give you a quick update on the grant project or projects that's starting to take place down at Kaiser Rapids. The first phase, I guess you could call it, is getting electrical ran over from Shimawa Road to where the new permanent restroom building will be. The conduit has been installed for that through the orchard. The vault has been set, and they're working on finalizing some tie-ins with that. So if you're over near the big toy and you see this huge hole and a bunch of orange fencing in the corner, that's what that's all about.
On that, are you going to be able to put a septic tank in?
We're working on it.
Well, I mean, I know it's a DEQ, right?
We're working on it.
Okay. Never mind.
Speaking of the big toy, we had a awesome group from the LDS Church stand up and say, we've got 300 volunteers that would love to come remove wood chips at the big toy. So, we have 300 people. That's a yard and a half per person. Wow. I can personally move. Less than an hour per person if you had enough wheelbarrows and if everybody could somehow stay out of each other's way, which I think is impossible. But I think with that number of people, they should be able to remove those chips in one day if they are motivated enough. There you go.
There's a motivate right there. Get them motivated.
You going to be at that group?
I actually had
no idea what I'm talking about.
At the very end of this, I could get a list of all important dates and issues that this board is talking about.
So anyways, that's great news.
You'll have another 300 people to do something. Do you
have one? September 9th, off of memory, I think, was the date that they're going to be showing up. We have to have it done. We're going to attempt to get the pour in place, poured sometime mid-September when the weather cools down. They can pour during hot weather. For those of you that don't know, the pour in place, fall protection, it's a rubberized surfacing. It takes like a type of glue that cures. Well, if it's over a certain temperature, the glue won't cure at the proper rate. So it can't be too hot. It also can't be too cold. And we live in Oregon, and so we get like a little window of good weather for that. So September is a very good month. So that's what our target date. I've also been working on the 2017-18 fiscal year budget. It's that time of year for us right now, trying to get that knocked through and finding all kinds of fun challenges within that, you know, as we've discussed, but continue to move forward with that. And spring is right around the corner. I mean, I'm staring March in the face going, okay, I'm going to start mowing here soon and getting some seasonals on and just trying to get things that we do during the winter finished up, ready for another workload to begin. So, yeah, that's where we're at.
Any questions for Robert?
Good job, Robert.
Thank you.
Council liaison report.
That'd be you.
That'd be you, Bruce.
Okay. What would you like me to report on?
Whatever you guys
want. What happened in council that pertains to parks, anything?
We had some heel thing, and nothing noteworthy to report. I wouldn't at this time.
Well, is there anything that, since this is televised, that you might reiterate on the people maybe?
We did find out that our generators work very well at the last meeting. So that was
great job.
Yes, those worked extremely well, especially during the three or four times that they went on, power went on and off. So that was kind of interesting. So, but anyway, council carried on.
Okay, that was short.
That will be all. That concludes my report, sir.
Okay. Is there any other business before this board?
Again, just to reiterate, Clag Creek Watershed Council did clean up Ben Miller Park, removed a bunch of blackberries down along the Urban Nomad location right underneath the bridge. Lots of leaves. The park looks generally pretty good. We picked up about 3 bags of trash that was deposited from the high waters. No bodies, which is, I guess, normal. it was great to have the Miller family out there helping out.
It would be an interesting travel slogan, just
no bodies, because it's normal. Again, coming up next month, the Watershed Council is hosting a cleanup thing here, so that'll interfere with my ability to do parks. And I just want to say again how much we appreciate Debbie and all of her work. with all of the three-quarter minus, all of the bark chips, all of the black protective surface that went in the park's big toy. And thanks again to Debbie and Robert for we need to really thank Debbie and Robert, because Debbie has cut and printed like 1,000 of these so far.
Wow.
And
what about my bloody fingers from typing in all of these?
I was going to get there. So I am so appreciative to them. You know, Robert has been putting up with my text messages and my emails and been very responsive, so I appreciate that, both of you, very much.
I just share. Every time I get one from you, I just share it with the public.
That's right. That's right. So that's all I got. Go to Kaiser.org, click on the scrolling banner, take the survey.
Counselor?
Mr. Chairman, I actually did recall one item that I will mention for the good of the order. One thing that we did do, we did get, council got an application from Safeway to possibly look at a gas station on their site. So kind of the ball got rolling, and Planning Commission's going to be taking that up and eyeballing that and seeing if that makes any sense.
Will that be a Planning Commission decision?
Planning Commission will take it up, look at it, and then make a recommendation.
Okay, they can't make the decision themselves.
No. And that applies to any Planning Commission decision. It's always a recommendation to City Council, as I recall.
Mm-hmm. You have a comment then, other than that?
I was going to ask Robert, and I'm not trying to label middle school kids, but do you have more problems with trash at Ben Miller Park?
Yes.
Okay.
And no. Graffiti.
Huh?
And graffiti.
Yep.
Well, I mean, it's...
I go down there at least right once a month, and I'm always two bags full of rubbish. And that's not to mention the people that are already cleaning up and stuff down there. It's just...
And how do you know it's middle school?
Well...
Because it's right next to it.
Because it's candy wrappers.
Drive by at 2:30 and see who's hanging out.
I was just saying, you know, it could be anybody... It just looks like middle school. Got it.
I have one comment. The Boy Scouts will be at Kaiser Rapids Park April 28th to the 30th. Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Jamboree.
Camperee. So Robert needs to come up with a whole bunch of stuff for us to do, because you're going to have another 300 guys.
I know you love Ivy.
29th and 30th. What?
I know you love Ivy.
I'd like some more challenges than Ivy. I liked fixing the bridge.
Some
last
of the ivy is still growing,
like
so.
That's challenging.
Fix the bridge?
You could have
the bouncy bridge and the big toy.
Oh.
You could have them fill the holes in the big open space with bark chips.
They fixed it last year.
Anyway, is there any other comments?
Go to Kaiser.org, click on the scrolling banner, take the survey.
No other comments.
You're going to give the sound man a heart attack.
Yes, you are. We're going to save him. We're going to stand adjourned at 7:20.